since we didn't have any money on the first film, I just sort of got a bunch of magazines on military technology and studied what it looked like and then created my own designs. So on the second picture, a lot of the design of the machines, the future machines, the Terminator endoskeleton and all that sort of thing was already done.
Jim had done a couple of sketches for the first movie. Just Terminator 2 had an A budget. So that included coming up with original devices and machines, weapons that, while being original, were sort of like cut from the same cloth.
The thing that remained to be created was the T-1000. What I did was brought in a few artists that I'd worked with in the past and had them just kind of hypothesize what a liquid chrome figure would look like in various configurations.
Some of the biggest changes occurred very early where, you know, was it going to be monstrous? And there were some sketches like that where it had these ridges and it looked very demonic, but Jim wanted it more to go into the direction of just this very amorphous, very simple human form, which is what you see, you know, when he walks out of the fire. It's a very simple representation of a man.
The storyboard guy or the visual effects artist basically spends more time thinking about a particular visualization of a scene than the writer, director has time to. In reading the script, I would break it down to visualize what it would be, to come up with the best angle for the effect. I usually try to do three or four different ways once I've done what's in the script. The approach that Jim takes is, what is the best way this is going to work for me? And that eventually is the way you end up doing it.
Because Jim has done so many action movies, he's very aware of the physical difficulties that will come up in numerous roles. And I think a strong consideration is always, will this actor be willing to do this, or can he do this? People might think that you don't need strong actors in an action picture because of all the special effects. A Jim Cameron movie does have all of those special effects, but still is a character-driven piece and has wonderful characters. You've got to have good actors as they're playing against all the special effects. That's what distinguishes his action movies from other people's action movies. I remember that Jim said to me very early on, John Connor is an extremely important role, and I have got to have a young actor who is a professional who will hit his marks. I cannot be working with a new kid. I can't do it. And one of the problems was is that this is supposed to be a streetwise kid and a kid who was a bit tough. And we saw all of these professional kids who couldn't have any toughness. And when they tried to act angry or tough, it just looked ridiculous. It didn't look real. It didn't look believable.
What I was looking for is a combination of a kind of a strength of character that wasn't necessarily a physical strength. I didn't want him to be just some little jock kid that looked like he could handle anything. He had to have a quality that needed protecting.
This was in the summertime, and one thing that I ended up doing was going to camps, motocross races, and then we decided we would start looking, in addition to theaters, at some kinds of organizations like Boys and Girls Clubs. And it was at that point that we contacted the Boys Club in Pasadena. And then I started walking around, and there was a kid leaning up against the wall by the pool.
This woman started staring at me, and I thought she was so weird because she just stared at me and smiled at me, and I'm just like, ugh.
And I walked over to him, and he was snarling at me. And I said, you want to audition for a movie?
A couple days later, we get a call. Remember that woman you talked to in the Pasadena Boys Club? And I'm like, yeah. And then she's, well, that's the casting director for Terminator 2. They want you to go up for the part of John Connor. And I'm just like, yeah! I went in for my first interview. And then I get a call later, and Mally Finn says, I want you to come out and try out with Linda Hamilton. So I went and tried out for it again and got really bashful and kind of shy, and I didn't do so well, and I almost got written off the list.
It was exactly what Jim was afraid of, that he couldn't repeat things right away. It was terribly difficult. He was very nervous.
Mally kept fighting for me, and she said, just give him one more chance. And I got an acting coach.
We found this wonderful man, Mike Muscat, who came in and worked with Eddie for a while, and we brought him back. He came in and did the scenes again.
I went in for my final interview, and I was really nervous. I looked around, and Jim's just like, you know, I could just see the look on people's faces. And then I just kind of just brightened up and did the part, and Jim lifted his head from his hands, and I left. And then right when I was getting in the car, Jim came out, and he said, you have the part.
At one of the first casting sessions, Jim said, we have to cast the T-1000 immediately because of the morphing and the process is time-consuming, and so we have to find someone right away.
Well, I wanted to find someone who would be a good contrast to Arnold, and I wanted somebody who won through different means, who was extremely fast, agile, quick.
He said the man should almost have a dancer's body, not like a gymnast, that's too muscular, but someone who is very powerful, lean, and lithe. He should look like he isn't a physical contest with Arnold. It's a different kind of power.
I think I was lucky that Jim, from what I understand, wanted an unknown for it, so that there wasn't any preconceived idea or something that they could recognize me from. And then when I went in there, I was just sort of tipped off that I was supposed to create some sort of an intense presence. And I started playing around with that with Mally, and there was something she saw, and she said, whatever that is, you know, whatever you're doing right now, why don't you keep that going, and we'll get it on tape.
It's almost like it's about senses with him. You know, you feel that he's very in touch with the world and analyzing it and observing it. And that's very much what the T-1000 is about, because he's a perfect chameleon.
T-2 was one of the first, it was the only script I've ever read where I literally did not know how to do something. Some of the things that were described were things that no one had ever done on screen before. And that's when you start to figure out just how strong you are as a producer, because you obviously, you can't panic. You have to say, okay, let's approach this rationally. The effect schedule basically drove the entire production schedule. Sometimes we were shooting things, not just out of order, which you always do in a film, but so completely out of order that you might be shooting the first part of one scene, 2 months or 3 months apart.
We begin breaking it down scene by scene, piece by piece, and deciding where we're going to start first. And there's always mixed in with that locations and initial concept meetings and illustrations. Jim carries with him an awful lot of knowledge about how he sees it, and already a lot of solutions about some of the problems. Steel Mills, the first thing was just accepting the enormity of the space and then trying to make it all work. Sketches are very good for giving you a kind of a three-dimensional sense of what pictorially you expect to have, but you can't really move through a drawing. So, you know, in a steel mill set, we had models for that. We did models to give a sense of what the spatial relationship is going to be when you start plugging elements in. We use a viewfinder camera, a tool that Jim is very comfortable with. There's some directors that aren't as comfortable with models and sets, but Jim very much likes them. Lets him walk away from a design feeling assured that what he has in his mind is going to be there when he finally walks onto the set.
Started in July, only three months before we started shooting, with a physical trainer, Anthony Cortez, working out 6 mornings a week, 2 to 3 hours every morning. Pretty intense. A lot of dietary changes, no fat at all. That's our joke, is there's no fat but what we make for ourselves. Not fate, but fat. And then after a month of that, I just sort of got my feet wet and got comfortable.
I started to work with Linda approximately 10 weeks prior to the production. She was 100% there, and she was very determined to learn and was very much into it.
It was really like entering the military and learning the mindset and coming up against myself in a big way. That was even more significant in terms of playing Sarah. And we did a lot of mostly weapons work, mission training, mind stuff, judo, just a lot of stuff to sort of hone in, zero in, clear the mind.
The idea is that we don't look at that as a movie. We look at this as a mission. You have to think like the character that you're going to be. Either it's your first nature or you're not going to do it. It's got to be your instinct. Otherwise, it's too late. And a really well-prepared and well-experienced person is not just the way that he handles his weapon. You don't want them to act it. You want them to be there.
When I started working out with Uzi, one of the things he wanted me to do was go stand in front of the ocean at like 5 in the morning or whatever, 6, 5. It was still dark, and I'd be standing in front of the Santa Monica Pier in the ocean absorbing the waves. And I was to create the power. And then Uzi never really called me Robert. It was always T-1000. As I said before, it was a very military kind of training. And he would just sort of come up and tap me on the shoulder, and we'd start running.
It's not about pumping iron or only being fast with weapons. It's a whole mental aspect. It's a mental aspect that you're really learning everything into little details. That gets you the feeling that you're ready for everything that comes up.
We're doing with Arnold Schwarzenegger in Terminator 2 is by giving him this makeup, is assisting him by giving him a little bit more of the character of the Terminator to work with and help him with his performance as the Terminator, so that it's not just, well, let's pretend half of my face is blown away. It's there. Chrome skull on top of Arnold's face, and then skin on top of the chrome skull on top of Arnold's face, and have it finessed enough that it actually did not feel like a big buildup, but stayed very close to his structure and held up. So from a makeup standpoint, that was a major challenge.
We would go to these drawers filled with appliances and pull out whatever we needed for the day. We constantly had to have running lists of what we will need, because the process of making one set of appliances takes half a day. To pour it, to cook it for several hours, to let it cool, then to pull it out at the right time. So if I had to call Stan and say, Stan, we need another dozen sets of stage 4 appliances for Arnold, I would need to give him a week's notice.
43 days I had to sit there for 5 hours each time and wait until those appliances were put on and the wires were put on, so the eye lights up. I just remember I had approximately 5 people at one time working on my face and working on my head.
It is a massive amount of work to put appliances on every single day. If you avoid one step, it can save hundreds of hours by the end of the picture. Usually Steve would work on one side of the face, I'd work on the other, and we would do a little do-si-do type of thing where I would work with one color, he would work with another, and I'd say, you ready? And we would switch. And it really turned out to be quite a practical way to do it. Arnold would come in at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, because we were shooting night. We would work on him from 3 o'clock until 8:30 at night. He would go out to the set, and we would film until 6 in the morning. He would come back in the trailer once everybody left to go home, and we would spend the next hour taking it off, because you can't just rip that stuff off. It'll tear the skin up a little bit. You have to be very careful taking it off.
Holy shit.
I need a vacation.
stunt coordinator's role is to actually bring the director's concept of the action to life. You're dealing with the wardrobe to make sure they have the right kind of clothes for certain types of protection. Make sure that the set was right. Make sure that it's padded here or it braces behind a breakaway wall or weakened a little bit over here. Make sure there's no slippery surfaces so where they can lose their footing. Dealing with the special effects department, telling them what you need, cars built a certain way, what type of explosives you want to use. The stunts and effects work hand in hand. And Tommy Fisher, he's knowledgeable, he's safe. And when it comes to designing rigs, he's done it for so many years that it makes me feel comfortable. The effects crew basically builds anything that you need specialized for a car, for a wreck, explosives and bullet hits. And I'll draw up diagrams for saying, well, you can do it this way or that way. This is more expensive, but you'll get better footage, you know. And working with Jim, it's great because it makes my job much easier with a director that understands physics and action. So we did a lot of extensive testing on that to make sure it was going to come out. From casting stunt people to playing parts to casting doubles, it's a 24-hour job, especially on a high-octane picture like Terminator 2.
Mr. Cameron are, you know, very knowledgeable in firearms, and when he wrote the script for T2, he wrote it with these guns in mind. T2 is very realistic. I have never used this many guns in one movie, 20, 30 different types of weapons that was used. The total quantity of weapons has got to be close to 200. Stenbridge is established since 1918. It's an old firm in the industry, and all we do is just movie guns. They are modified to fire theatrical blanks only, but in terms of safety, always treat them as a regular firearm. Treat them with the proper respect of a live gun, then no one will get hurt. Prop master and his assistant will pass out the safety equipment like face shields, goggles, earplugs, of that nature. I will usually talk to the actor, actresses, or the stuntmen or extras to ensure they know the operation aspect of the firearm. People who does not need to be there are usually asked to leave the set so we have a safe filming environment.
We had Robert Patrick come up here, and we painted a little 2-inch by 2-inch grid all over him, and shot him out on the back lot, walking with two cameras that were synced, so I could study not only his front motion, but also his side motion, frame for frame. We also took a lot of pictures of him, and we scanned those in as well. And from that, I built the skin over top of the actual bones. He was going to be the digital stunt double of Robert. In order to get that detail, right, we should probably scan his head.
Using some equipment that's called cyberware. And what they do is they scan a laser light onto anything you want. It can be a person, in our case, it was a person. It just gathers the data, puts it into the computer, and the computer then puts it together in three-dimensional space.
We now have to take our CG element itself, which is a character, an actor in the film, and make that come to life. We have to bring it to life like a puppeteer would. We have a lot of very talented animators who are able to essentially act through the computer.
What makes it really breathe is the secondary stuff. Mannerisms with the face, mannerisms with the fingers, muscles, all that kind of stuff really brings it to life.
At first, he just sort of rose up very geometrically and stopped, and his head didn't move, and he just sort of stopped and stared. Well, the next time we did it, we decided, okay, we'll have his head rotate a little bit, just the slightest amount, his shoulder move a little bit, you know, that kind of thing. And all those very small amounts of animation, as simple as they may seem, really seem to put the life into it.
But that's what it takes. You have to keep layering, layering, layering detail on top of it, because the real world is very detailed.
We now have to create a computer camera that's the same as the real camera, a computer set the same as the real set, and a digital actor that sort of has the same perspective and action and motivation as the actors on the real set.
The CG elements must cast shadows on the scene already in the image. The elements that are in the image must cast shadows on the CG element. If the environment is very shiny, it must reflect the CG element in the environment, so we have to add those reflection components to the picture. Similarly, the CG element itself, if it's shiny, must also reflect the environment.
You create a picture and then wrap that picture around the sculpture. That's called texture mapping.
The biggest problem was dividing up all the shots and sticking them in five separate categories. These shots were sort of broken down into the human figure team, the death team, shots that pertain to what we call the pseudopod shots, or polyalloy shots, and digital metamorphosis shots.
Every shot poses some problem. Every single shot did, and it poses something completely new.
We were pushing the limits of everything. The amount of disk space we had, the amount of memory we had in the computers, the amount of CPUs we had. Each shot, even though it only lasted 5 seconds on the screen, typically would take about 8 weeks to complete.
A lot of our CG shots did have defects that we never solved, but we could solve them with digital paintwork.
And they were pretty much done, you know, on a Macintosh and Photoshop.
It was very easy working with Jim Cameron on the show. I mean, he really knows just what he wants. He was very clear about what he wanted. He gave tremendous feedback because he's one of the guys around who's able to grasp the technology and then write material for it.
The interesting thing about Cameron is that when he came in here with Terminator in the script, he knew what techniques he was going to use already, and he knew how he wanted to do the shots, even though no one had ever done it before.
It's important for people to realize that what we do is not makeup or special effects or anything that is categorized. What we do is we create characters for film. The process of creating a character is like the process of creating a film. It always starts with the written word. What is the character? What are the characteristics of this character? Second step is to take that written word and create a drawing. Take all the straps off and just say, okay, this is what he's all about. This is what the character looks like. This is what he has to do. Now, how are we going to do that? If you can do it with makeup, do it with makeup. Allow an actor to do it. If you can't do it with makeup, ideally you do it with robotics because it's live. If you can't do it with makeup and you can't do it with robotics, then in comes the magic of the computer. Whatever it takes, that's what we do. From the beginning, whether it was live action or composite photography or stop motion animation or miniature or computer effects, all of those effects were married to Stan Winston Studio effects. There was this wonderful marriage between Stan Winston Studio and ILM that allowed it to be this wonderful seamless blend of techniques, of robotic techniques, of makeup techniques, of computer techniques.
Did that, and then there was just a point where they couldn't deal anymore, and they separated.
Oh.
Jim actually wanted to up the scale. We made the models and the whole environment half again as big as the first time. There is a point in models and miniatures when they get too big, you start to lose the reason why you're doing it in miniature. A set is about 50 feet wide, 30 feet deep, with a sort of forced perspective at the horizon. There's a large area to light. The number of flying and ground HKs involved. Split screening it in with live action, interactive light and missiles and explosions on both sides of the line, both live action explosions and doing tilt down. Particularly since marrying up the foreground and background with explosions going off on both halves, which changes the light and the color on the sets. The same puppet built for the first Terminator is employed again in Terminator 2. That shot was kind of complicated and time-consuming to build. The real trick is to not try to make the entire effect happen all at once. Break it up into component parts. The farthest layer is a miniature background with a flying HK and explosions. That was printed into a rear projection plate. The two images, VistaVision plates, are now rear projected onto a single large screen where we blended the two pictures together and animated in Go Motion that puppet in front of these double rear projection screens. There were four backgrounds combined to be two and two that were shot to end up with one and one, the two large endoskeletons. And full-scale set pieces were placed in front of two large screens, rephotographed with interactive light and some smoke. Then that went through opticals and we added interactive flashing lights when they were firing the lasers. It's more complicated than you would think to really integrate it, and then no one knows anything was done, and then you've done your job. It was a quarter scale miniature, which made it 18 feet long. The set was 70 feet long. The asphalt area into the miniature factory building was 20 feet wide. The whole reason why you do some of these things miniature is because you get something that big and that unwieldy. The costs become very prohibitive. When it's smaller, you're controlling it. When you roll it over, you don't have to have a whole brand new thing. You patch it up a little bit and you do it again. And you know that you're going to do it over and over until you get it and work out the details. When it's a full-scale truck, you can't do that.
What we were asked by Jim to do with this nuclear nightmare was to create a tremendous motivation for Sarah. So this nightmare had to be exceedingly powerful, exceedingly realistic, and pretty much punch you between the eyes. Could we make this message so strong that it would really knock people over and make them feel the sense of what this is? Be real about it, not to pretend we could survive it. I've had more reaction to that nuclear war sequence than anything practically I've done on film.
The blast coming across the city was something of a challenge, and we thought about several different ways of doing it. An idea crossed Bob's mind contacting Jay Roth of Electric Image, who had been developing some animation software for Macintosh. Eventually, what he generated was several elements that wound up being incorporated into a matte painting. In addition to that, we inserted a miniature of a building getting blown away that we shot at high speed and did it as a projection directly onto the glass in front of the matte painting.
Worked with several different scales, built a series of metal racks that were the substructure of the buildings, and we covered those with breakaway surfaces. We experimented with a lot of different things. We wound up taking plaster and mixing it in various densities. We found ourselves having to come up with materials for the insides of the building that could be mass-produced and assembled crudely but visually effectively. We found that matzo crackers were in the right scale for rooms. They had the little segment lines so we could break them up and glue them in, and they were cheap. We had balsa wood chunks, metal chunks, plaster pieces. We also found that various types of cereals like shredded wheat and cornflakes were spray painted because, again, that looks like broken masonry. Facing across from the miniature buildings, about 9 feet away, was a row of air cannons and several Ritters and E-fans. We found ourselves augmenting all of these with upwards of 25 or 30 cables attached to the back of the set. All these wires also pulled the model apart internally. In addition, we layered in several exposures of particles blown across the frame with an air cannon.
We essentially did three cameras photographing the entire setup at once. It was either 8 or 9 times that we did those over. The reset time seemed to average between 2 and 2.5 days.
What we wound up doing was making a quarter scale section of the steel mill and filling it with Maalox, white tempera, and some water. What we were looking for was a very white, thick liquid that would allow us to pull a mat and print back in a overexposed version of this white liquid through diffusion. So we would then wind up with this glowing sense of pouring material.
The need for having mercury doing something that it doesn't want to do were among the most frustrating things to have to shoot. Bob came up with the idea of using a table that we could bring the center down just ever so slightly, and that slight amount of concave shape to it could cause the mercury to flow and to move from where it was set up. Now in practice, it became very difficult to do this. So in frustration, he grabbed a can of spray adhesive and sprayed it on the surface of the miniature, and mercury stopped right at the edge of it.
I'll be back.
Those words took on new meaning in the fall of 1990 when cast and crew reunited in the Mojave Desert to continue the story of Sarah Connor and her fight against the machines of the future.
The important element that's changed in her life since we saw her last is that she's had her son, John Connor, and he's now 10 years old. The new Terminator of the film is not targeted on her anymore. The child now himself is the target.
Okay.
For Cameron, Terminator 2 was only a matter of time.
Action!
It was inevitable that a Terminator sequel would get made, and I wanted to be at the helm. I wanted to make sure it didn't kind of drift off the concept of what it should be about.
Cameron's vision of a killer cyborg from the future hit a chord with audiences worldwide.
The Terminator represented something to people, a kind of a dark side of the human psyche. People want to have that fantasy of being able to do exactly what they wanted to do whenever they wanted to do it.
I need your clothes, your boots, and your motorcycle. Hey. You forgot to say please.
It took us all, I think, a while to realize that the Terminator had kind of permeated into the culture, and it just kept getting reflected back to me in so many ways.
Arnold Schwarzenegger, the Terminator.
Arnold was always a very strong force in trying to get the sequel made.
I said to Jim Cameron, I said, you know, we should have an ongoing story because we're dealing here with such an interesting subject.
I knew, instinct told me that based on the strength of the first film, that there would be another one. It's just, you're never ready.
Several of the original Terminator crew returned for the sequel, including director of photography Adam Greenberg and Terminator effects creator Stan Winston.
Sequel must be true to the first film, but yet it must be more than the first film. We have to give them what they got in the first, and we have to give them something new and fresh. And I think that's what we've done in Terminator 2.
How can Arnold be starring in the sequel?
A Terminator is built in a factory, and there's one after another after another, and they all look like Arnold. I guess it's just because he's cute.
This Terminator, however, isn't just another pretty face.
There's more sophistication to the way it will look, and bigger, much bigger things will happen on the screen.
Action! Action, Arnold! CO2!
For 6 months, Terminator 2 combined the efforts of over 1,000 filmmakers, shooting day and night throughout the state of California to capture the many action sequences of the script. The production actually changed the course of a river to shoot high-speed chases in the extensive flood control channels of Los Angeles.
Roll, guys, roll!
The tight quarters and massive filming equipment often paralleled the action of the scenes being shot. A defunct steel mill was resurrected by the filmmakers, recreating the intense heat and light of molten steel.
Yeah.
Ironically, actual temperatures in the mill averaged 42 degrees, making it difficult for the actors to work up a sweat. And in Northern California, a team of expert pyrotechnicians staged one of the largest police shootouts in cinematic history.
And action, Arnold!
Tell me that wasn't a rush.
Their crowning achievement, however, was blowing up a four-story office building.
Were we supposed to roll?
That was a rehearsal.
I was waiting for your cue, Jim.
Arnold and I working together, it's just like it was on the first picture. He's one of the most professional people I've ever worked with. He has incredible concentration. He takes physical direction like no actor I've ever worked with. And it's really a joy to work with him.
Yeah, exactly.
Really it's part of the shoot.
It was before my method acting seminar.
Although then, in 1984, he paid a lot of attention to the acting. He pays much more attention to the acting now, the way he goes about directing actors, how much time he spends with rehearsals, how much time he spends with perfection and with moves and gestures.
I think you both go, you freeze.
So I would say that in that area, he's much smarter and much more sophisticated. I mean, he wants to do basically everything because he has such a clear vision of what he wants to see, and see him ending up running with the smoke machine and creating smoke in front of the camera and then putting on blood and trying to do your makeup. That's why people always say that a Jim Cameron movie has a certain look, because it's a total representation of what he wants to see.
Long before the cameras roll, Cameron and crew are hard at work, designing sequences and testing ideas in a unique mix of filmmaking and science.
I do a lot of visual research, I do a lot of technical research. The more fantastic the subject, the more realistic the situation needs to be.
Using extremely detailed models, Cameron designed sequences with the aid of a thumb-sized video camera. By blocking the scene in miniature, production designer Joe Nemec can alter a location or set to meet the specific needs of the scene. Also during pre-production, an ex-Israeli commando provided the cast with military combat and weapons training. Since the character of Sarah has become an expert marksman, Linda was required to master a variety of guns and assault rifles.
It was really like entering the military and learning the mindset and coming up against myself in a big way. That was even more significant in terms of playing Sarah.
Very good.
She has so set herself down a path, a concentrated path of duty, that she's lost all touch with her son.
You cannot risk yourself even for me. Do you understand? You're too important.
She's a great warrior, but for what? You know, so what? She doesn't have anything that makes it worth while, you know. And also, my life. It's like, oh, we don't even notice the gunshot anymore.
Why does it want me?
It was a nuclear war.
Sarah has lived with the certain knowledge of the destruction of the world on a certain date for so long, and it haunts her dreams and nightmares every night. And it's driven her kind of to the point of madness, really, as it would anybody who really had to confront that knowledge.
Because I knew it happened! It happened!
We experience the end of the world through Sarah's eyes, a process that called for the strictest sense of realism. But even more powerful and haunting are Sarah's visions of the people.
And he comes down, and action, he jumps off and covers up. Oh, stop. What'd you do? See commando 10 times?
When we had to create ashen bodies that were going to be blown away by a nuclear holocaust, it was very unsettling. And it was the one time when you got a little uncomfortable. because it wasn't pleasant to look at while you were shooting it. But it is the important aspect of the film.
Judgment Day, the day Sarah was told the war would start, clearing the path for humanity's successor, the machines. Future war. For Terminator 2, Cameron mobilized an army of actors, stunt people, and special effects crews to create the final battle between humanity and the machines. This battle took place on many levels in Terminator 2, as the crew executed one successful vehicle stunt after another.
That is a cut.
One scene required the Terminator to climb from a speeding pickup onto a heavy tanker, a feat performed by Arnold's stunt double, Peter Kent. After a successful spin out, the truck was rolled onto its side and dragged by a team of tractors. Peter rode the sliding tanker like a surfboard. To protect young John Connor, the human resistance has sent the Terminator itself.
My mission is to protect you.
Who sent you?
You did.
This is deep.
Playing the role of young John Connor is newcomer Eddie Furlong.
It's almost, in a way, the classic story. I mean, he literally was just plucked off the streets of Pasadena and whipped into the vortex of making a movie.
And Jim said, Eddie, I was going to tell you Friday, but don't tell anybody. But we picked you for this film. And I felt like hugging Jim, but he's a guy, so I didn't hug him.
Cast with less than a month before production, Eddie began an intense period of preparation. In addition to his regular education, he received physical training, acting lessons, and motorcycle classes.
Funny thing is, I'm sure it's nothing like anything he ever expected, and it's a total left turn in his life. But on the other hand, children have this remarkable capacity to just deal with things, whatever life throws them. They don't know how the world is supposed to be yet, so they just think that's okay. You know, it can be like this if it wants to be.
One of the many tasks Stan Winston and crew undertook was enhancing the original Terminator makeup design.
Originally, there were a number of stages designed or considered as Arnold stages in makeups for this particular production. An actor must know going into a situation like this that there is physical stress with this process. Fortunately, Arnold Schwarzenegger is a pro.
3 more hours of this, I don't know how much longer I can take this.
He attacks it as a pro. He doesn't complain.
All right. But I need my foot massages, my oatmeal, my Austrian Christmas music. I need it all. Go ahead. Do it.
This pre-made up piece here is going to be glued to Arnold's face with the help of Arnold holding it.
Hold on a second. Okay, now, it's the glue we use. It makes these arms pop up and get all swollen. On days when the makeup doesn't turn out 100%, I just sneak by the camera and rub a little Vaseline on the lens, and then everything looks fine. But don't tell the DP that. He gets really upset. This was so funny.
During the production, makeup artist Jeff Don and Steve Laporte and hairdresser Peter Toffball would transform Arnold into the flesh-covered Terminator an estimated 35 times, totaling 6 consecutive days in a makeup chair for Arnold.
Not too much, because if you put too much blood on it, you can't see the work that's been done. You can't see the metal and the flesh that's gone. It just looks like a big bloody mess, like you slapped some hamburger on it.
That's a good example, Jeff.
Hamburger?
I'm proud of
you. Well, I'm hungry right now, so I use hamburger.
People accept this possibility that there can be a blend between a human component and a machine component. And I think it's just an aspect of our lives right now that we're so surrounded by machines all the time. And the fact that we can accept that, to me, is the most amazing thing of all.
What it is I'm too handsome. No camera can take all these good looks. So what they do in every movie, basically, is they put appliances on and terrible makeup on to kind of tone my looks down a little bit so I match up to the rest of the actors in the movie.
So tell me, Linda, what do you think about that?
I'm a little too pretty, too, for this movie, so.
All right. Wow! Was my breath that bad?
2.5-3 hours and he's done. The next stage for the makeup is stage 5, 6, 7. And it's basically the same that Arnold had before, just more chrome, more appliances. He'll have his eye plugged up so he won't be able to see out of it. And it'll take probably an hour, hour and a half longer to put on. He's going to love it.
As one might imagine, Sarah has trouble accepting the Terminator as an ally.
Although she doesn't know that he's going to come back, she knows that it's a possibility, so she's ready. No affection. You know, I've kept it really clean.
Do you know what you're doing?
I've detailed files on a human anatomy.
I bet. Makes you a more efficient killer, right?
Correct.
Terminator in this film adapts certain human characteristics.
You gotta listen to the way people talk. And if someone comes off to you with an attitude, you say, hasta la vista, baby.
Hasta la vista, baby.
That character slowly develops by the very fact of hanging around a human being.
Jesus, you're gonna kill that guy.
Of course, I'm a Terminator.
Listen to me very carefully, okay? You're not a Terminator anymore, all right?
And all that registers, and I start dealing with all those kind of emotions.
The Terminator sent to kill young John is unlike any killing machine ever imagined.
I call him a mimetic polyalloy, meaning that that he's made of a substance that can imitate anything.
Playing the T-1000 is Robert Patrick.
Jim was looking for somebody that was sort of a mixture between the protector character, which was Michael Biehn in the first, and Arnold Schwarzenegger, which is the Terminator. And I think he was looking for somebody that could look like he could possibly just be a human, and yet could be a Terminator, could handle the intensity to be a Terminator.
Well, I wanted to find someone who would be a good contrast to Arnold. If the 800 series is a kind of human Panzer tank, then the 1000 series had to be a Porsche. An advanced prototype Terminator who was more fearsome than the old model. The thing I like about Robert was he kind of looks like a cat in a way. It's almost like it's about senses with him. You know, you feel that he's very in touch with the world and analyzing it and observing it.
My character wants to completely take out John Connor. That's his mission. He's relentless, tenacious killing machine, and he won't stop.
Though their missions are exact opposites, both Terminators stem from the same creator, the unseen supercomputer called Skynet.
So it's like this is the first time you've had to deal with evil,
right?
Because Terminators don't fight Terminators.
Right.
It's never happened.
We stem from the same technology, so we've got to have some like programming there.
Are you the legal guardian of John Connor?
That's right, officer. What's he done now?
So we're both killing machines, we're just different types.
There was a guy here this morning looking for him, too.
Yeah, a big guy on a bike. Has that got something to do with this?
The new Terminator, really, with this new capabilities, is much more threatening.
Now I'm basically death. You know, they're running from death.
Both Terminators are programmed to complete their missions at all costs and without question. But Sarah has decided to confront her destiny and takes matters into her own hands.
I need to know how Skynet gets built. Who's responsible?
The man most directly responsible is Miles Bennett Dyson.
She decides that the only way to stop the future that she knows is going to happen is to kill the man that builds the chip that starts the war.
in a very real way, she becomes the Terminator of the second film, at least at a kind of a psychological level.
For cast and crew, Terminator 2 has been more than a reunion.
It has been very intense to work, and you know, a lot of night shooting and a lot of long hours and so on. And I'm very honored and happy that I'm able to do the second one.
In 1984, Cameron transformed Arnold into one of the screen's most memorable villains. 7 years later, the process is reversing itself. The Terminator is becoming a protector.
Ultimately, the film is about the value of human life. No matter how inconsequential you may seem to others or even to yourself, your individual existence may have great value in the future.
Grab it, go! Go! No! No!
They have a job to do, protect her son, and they do it.
In this particular movie, we had to duplicate every principal actor animatronically.
In the scene where the Terminator must force his way past a SWAT firing squad, Stan was called upon to create an Arnold double that could withstand a barrage of gunfire.
There's nothing that we can do that will actually duplicate living things. We can come close, but we can't do it exactly.
It's incredible, huh?
It's looking good. Yeah. For this, considering the fact that it's going to be... We are making animatronic duplications of living things. 2, 3, 4. Perfect.
Lighten up.
Very nice.
It's just a movie. What? Okay, you don't get paid, so what? I make it for you, okay? Relax.
For Sarah's nightmare, Winston's crew designed and created several duplicates of Linda Hamilton, all of which were destroyed in the creation of the haunting nuclear sequence.
Mommy.
Destroying Los Angeles was a task given to Forward Productions under the direction of Bob Skotak. Vast miniature cityscapes were built in tremendous detail for the sole purpose of their destruction. But the truly revolutionary effects involve creating the T-1000, the deadliest machine ever built.
It just blew my mind. To actually see it, and you go, wow, they've morphed you. You're a liquid mercury man. You're liquid chrome. I don't think I'll get over it, and I totally believed it.
Creating the T-1000 required the combined efforts of Stan Winston's company and Industrial Light and Magic, under the direction of Dennis Muren.
At the beginning of this show, Jim had the boards already done. And you have to start with storyboards. You have to know what you're doing at the beginning. Can it even be done? A show like this, you know, is it technically feasible to even do it now? And Jim was hoping it was, and I thought it was. You know, so we all agreed that we could do it.
It was a constant, you know, little juggling act in the very beginning to figure out what was going to be done optically, what was going to be done as a real life effect, and then what things from us would be needed for ILM to help them work things out optically, and vice versa. And it was it just worked out as perfect as it possibly could have.
When the T-1000's abilities went beyond what was possible with animatronics, makeup, and prosthetics, ILM was given the task of creating the effects optically, literally redefining state-of-the-art for computer animation.
Computer-generated images are a way of coming up with new effects, especially when we've been doing traditional effects for 80 years. And you're starting to see, I think, a lot of sort of the limits of traditional effects, sort of the it's very hard to use the same tools and do the different things all the time.
Dennis and I sat down and conceived the process, and we sort of decided to concentrate on the Robert Patrick form, because Robert is the T-1000. We decided we're going to study his body, we're going to watch his movements, we're going to find a way to capture his quality, the way he walks, the way he runs, the way he behaves, the way his body changes shape. And that was, for us, was going to be the key that drove our visual approach to the whole T-1000.
At the making of the models, the studying Robert Patrick, we got Robert, and he was up here, and we painted a grid on him and shot a lot of footage of him, and we could see how the grid moved as his muscles moved and his body's moved around. That was way back in the beginning of the show.
And so that gives you an extremely powerful guide for creating a real Robert Patrick walk, a real Robert Patrick run, which is in fact the T-1000 walk, the T-1000 run. So it's absolutely critical to our whole process.
We're trying to always duplicate human beings. Everybody's shooting for human beings. This is really the first successful step to adding real life to an otherwise inanimate piece of geometry. You know, it's the wrinkles, you know, it's the slight mannerisms of the eyes and the hands and stuff, just like a real human. That's the kind of thing, that's the extra step we wanted to take. We were destined to do that or nothing. We knew that other people had come so far, we wanted to go beyond that.
I dabbled in this a little bit in the abyss with the water tentacle that formed the faces of Ed Harris and Mary Elizabeth Mastrantonio, and that proved to be very compelling imagery that people remembered indelibly from that movie. So that kind of encouraged me to take it a step further, or many steps further.
As on the Abyss, ILM employed a revolutionary laser scanning process to capture Robert Patrick's movements and form.
And one of the most powerful ways, or one of the most exciting ways to use it, is to get people's facial expressions in the computer.
I'm sitting in a chair, you know, like this, and I can't move this way, I can't move this way. I've got to stay totally control, hit this emotion, and lock on this expression, you know, like,
We can reconstruct the actor's face. It's a very free process. You can sort of go with what's happening and digitize his expressions as you wish. And we can immediately work with them, animate, model, create human, very realistic, very strong human faces.
Get out.
I mean, we work on this stuff, and every day, you know, we still have not lost the spirit of amazement when we see what's coming out.
It's new, and that's what's necessary, is we can't have a sequel and just have it more of the same. There's some wonderful new surprises in Terminator 2.
Bringing the T-1000 to life has been a group effort. I knew I was in good hands, like with ILM and Stan Winston. I knew I was working with the best of the best. And I'd just like to thank them and the crew and my cast members.
I was wondering if you could tell me, I mean, if you know.
Know what?
Well, if you know where it came from.
You know, I asked them that very same question once. You know what they told me?
Don't ask.
There's so much unexplored territory, and it seemed like the ceiling was so high, it was out of sight.
Because I remember we went through all kinds of gyrations trying to figure out how to do this darn water weenie.
T2, in my mind, is sort of the breakthrough film for computer graphics.
If you're not an artist, don't expect the computer to do it for you, because it ain't going to do nothing. The computer does nothing. It's a tool.
So what's your story?
As an aficionado of visual effects from my fan days, even before I became a practicing filmmaker, I was always trying to stay abreast of what was being done in visual effects. Star Wars and motion control had really pretty much revolutionized visual effects. But then during the 80s, you saw CG really, really starting to develop, but it was always kind of a niche thing. It was used for certain types of animation that couldn't be done any other way, and it hadn't really been integrated into the mainstream of feature production.
A lot of stuff had been done up till then that was only partially successful or a very small number of shots or whatever.
When I started at ILM, what the computer graphics department was being used for was for stylized, non-realistic things.
We were still a long way from CG becoming an important player at that point.
The company needed something to gravitate around, and that we could sort of prove the technology is either going to go somewhere or it isn't.
Well, as we began to work with computer graphics, it became apparent that, you know, almost anything that you wanted to do with it, there was a way to do it if you put enough time and effort into it.
There were kind of clues that would work, and there were plenty of people to say it wouldn't. And whenever that happens, I found that to be a sign of something.
We were in uncharted territory now, making up history as we went along.
When I wrote the sequence of the pseudopod in the abyss, I just saw what it should look like in my head, and I would do whatever was necessary to make that happen. We explored a lot of different ways of doing it, and we kept coming back to computer graphics animation as the most likely solution, but in a sense the scariest one.
Well, the big break for us on the abyss was having a filmmaker who was willing to take, you know, a sort of substantial sequence and trust that, okay, we're going to do computer graphics for this. We're going to try a kind of relatively new technique that no one had really tried to use in this way before.
They had been doing enough R&D that they were ready to make the leap. They were ready to integrate a character in that way. And so they showed us some proof of concept, and we were off to the races. We were doing a film with The Abyss that was highly realistic in terms of the research and the production design, the sets, the actors. I mean, we certainly didn't pull any punches in terms of the attempt to do dramatic reality. So integrating a computer graphics effect into that was pretty scary because it had to look real. And not only had to look real, it had to look stunning. It had to look mind-blowing. So the bar was set very high.
Jim's one of the rare people to be able to, you know, work his script and direct his script around the available technology, and to be able to sort of see the next step and take a chance on it. He's always a risk taker, and was being someone who would understand that it was going to be hard to do.
I recall it being sort of 10 or 12 months of hell getting these shots done, and it was like pulling teeth because the render times are so horrendously long.
Our entire computer graphics department had 900 megabytes of online storage. That was it. And we had to do the entire show with it.
So much had to be learned about refractive ray tracing and surface reflections and how you animate and how you take the facial data from the actors, which was done by laser scan, and how you animate with that, and how much of it is keyframe animation, and how much of it we actually had the actors do themselves. So there was quite a bit involved in it.
John Knoll came along with Photoshop, and it wasn't quite out yet.
The Abyss was the first feature film that Photoshop was used on it, and I spent a bunch of time in this very early version of Photoshop, kind of pasting all these things together, making these nice, just seamless reflection environments. Another thing that I did was for that first digital composite that in The Abyss with the door closing on the pseudopod and falling down and splashing on the floor, we had to have animated rotomats that had to be painted with soft edges, and I ended up just painting those in Photoshop.
It's, you know, digital comp that's all put in there, and, you know, just goes right by the audience, but it was, you know, one of the few examples up till that time of all digital shot, and it brought everybody up to sort of a new level.
It was just a kind of dynamic convergence of elements, and so it just seemed like it fell into place at that point.
We proved we could do 16 shots in 5 months, whatever the thing was, on budget, pretty close. That was unheard of, to be able to do something like that.
And it was an image that you could tell just by looking at it that couldn't have been done with stop motion. It couldn't have been done with, you know, you're seeing something new, and there was something, you know, very exciting about that.
You're telling me that this thing can imitate anything it touches?
The concept of the liquid metal man was an idea that I had a good 10 years earlier when I had been just conceptualizing the first film, and there was no way to do it. Claymation was the only thing I could think of back in the early 80s, and I didn't think that was going to be mind-blowing enough. So when we got to the second film, the residue of that early idea was still floating around, but in the meantime we'd done The Abyss, and so there was some proof of concept that some kind of liquid character could actually be done. That ultimately became the T-1000.
I think Jim, in the back of his mind, sort of possibly wrote it to just keep us, you know, keep us thirsty all the time.
The T-1000 was an absolutely natural character for digital filmmaking and unnatural for any other kind of filmmaking. So Jim, I think, is the first major director to have created stories that are digital films.
The pseudopod in The Abyss, it was contained within a single sequence in the film. If it didn't work, push come to shove, we could have cut around it and bridged across it in some way and not lost the entire film. That was not the case with Terminator 2, because the T-1000 was throughout the film, and he was integral to the understanding of the entire film.
And so it really had to work there. So when we decided to go to the next level with the T-1000, we were really setting ourselves a challenge that was, again, an order of magnitude more difficult than the last time out.
This show was pretty terrifying for most people when it started up. You know, the guys say, we can't do this yet, you know. What are they trying to do? They can't do it. I didn't go into the show relying on CG to be able to do it. I had a backup plan. I was ready at any time to start pulling out and get the model shop going and getting the foam being, you know, whipped up and castings and everything like that if we had to, and try, you know, other techniques to do it.
Well, it was definitely a leap of faith that we were going to hang the entire success or failure of a $100 million film on a relatively unproven technology and technique, and do so in a ridiculously short period of time.
You know, I wouldn't have done T2 if it hadn't been for being able to get the digital compositing to work, because I knew that the CG was unreliable in being able to produce perfect images every single time, and it took so long, so many iterations, to get rid of this little problem and that little problem. These problems may be only on there for two or three frames. And I got a Mac and art and right next to where I was, and Photoshop, and I think it was Doug Chang was in our art department, and he was my sort of what I call my secret weapon. And when an element of T2 worked up to a certain point and didn't work anymore, we were now in the digital world, he could paint the problem out.
So many of those CG shots with the T-1000, the background plates were actually shot before we shot the scene, because the schedule was so rigorous for them that we couldn't wait until we shot the scene in the shooting schedule. So we had to imagine what the scene was going to look like, build a set of just the background for that particular effect shot, whether it was a piece of floor, whether it was the elevator, or wherever we could contain it in that way, shoot all those plates in advance, agree on the lighting in advance, agree on the camera angle in advance, give them the plates, have them begin working on the visual effect shots, and then weeks or months later, we actually shot the scene that ran up to it and came after it. And somehow those shots had to drop right in.
What was special about Terminator 2 was this was the first time we were going to marry these technologies. We were going to marry live-action puppeted effects with digital effects.
Sam Winston would start the effect, the CG would do the hard part, let's say one of the shotgun wounds healing or a head changing geometry in some way that a physical puppet couldn't do. And then he would carry on after that, where, you know, we had various types of rubber suits that had been vacuum metalized so that they were reflective as if they were liquid metal, and in quick cuts we got away with it. Given the fact that that was the only way we could accomplish it in the schedule that we had available, I think it was quite remarkable. And I think it was amazing that we actually even took that chance.
I think in T2 we had about 47 or so CG shots. And yet the memory that people have of the film is it's a lot more than that. You know, well, it had some Stan Winston work that was just amazing, and it's the whole lead up, it's Arnold, it's, you know, Robert, it's everything that Jim did, the whole thing coming together, and then our effects in there.
You know, part of it was that every single frame of that computer animation was so costly that we really had to be stingy about how we used it, so which meant that we had to be clever in the way that we leveraged it so that we'd get the most impact.
It was the right time to do it. We were right on the edge of everything, technology, great story, great director. The team to bring this stuff to life was here at ILM. Everybody was focused on it. And we managed to, you know, to pull it off. A lot of work in a reasonable amount of time that just hadn't been done before.
Cameron has always posed problems that have been interesting to solve, right? And that have been new. So it drove the industry.
What the fuck is this? What the fuck is going on?
T2 has been the one that the technology breakthroughs came on, and the organization came together to be able to do it. We had all the components necessary to digitize film, manipulate it, and then go back out onto film again, which now everybody does, but at that time, it was, you know, unheard of.
For this breakthrough work to be in a high-profile film certainly does a lot to catch people's attention and move things forward. We had first done Morphing on Willow, but that didn't quite grab people's attention the way that the Morphing in T2 did.
So this was the thing they remembered, and they attributed all the success to that. But really, it's always a whole.
And then suddenly it became kind of a fad. There was a, you know, four-year stretch where you couldn't turn on the TV without seeing Morphing in a television commercial.
Morphs had an impact on the market, and unfortunately so many of the satellite companies literally had a price list for it. You know, Morphing, $35, you know.
I think everybody always looks for a simple kind of one
stroke answer for why a film is successful, and this is always a mistake.
They see this and they get excited and they go, give me some of that. Can you give me some of that in my movie? But they don't really get it.
People thought, oh, if I just make a film that's got those effects in it, it'll be successful, and that wasn't necessarily the case. You know, people became fascinated by it, and that's okay. That's cool. That's fun. That helps establish the tools and make them available. But the things that interested me were not an emulation of that which had been done, but people that were using the tools in new ways.
T2 really got the company jazzed up about CG, but it didn't get the industry jazzed up, and I could never figure that out.
I think even after T2, CG still felt pretty experimental to me.
I think it was too hard to look at that shape-changing guy and saying, what else can it be? But it's a lot easier to look at a dinosaur and say, oh, it could be another type of dinosaur. Or it could be a dragon, or it could be maybe someday a person.
I think when I saw how they took what they had learned there and they applied it to what they did on Jurassic Park, that it really blew the doors off it.
A lot of people come to me and say, boy, that Jurassic Park was the breakthrough film, wasn't it? And I say, I don't think so. To me, Terminator 2 was the breakthrough CG film.
If we had not done The Abyss and if we had not done Terminator 2, we wouldn't have done Jurassic Park. You know, and hence the industry would be 5 years behind.
We set the bar up to a new level and Jurassic Park moved it, but that was a very different thing. They weren't relying on something that had been done before. And then, you know, Death Becomes Her did. And then after that, I think it started to branch out and so many people were trying so many new things at that point that it really just exploded.
In a panic, they tried to pull the plug.
It was a convulsive time because you had so many people whose entire stock in trade was optical-based film effects.
The CG work we were doing was so foreign to everyone here that was kind of like its own thing and didn't really threaten anybody. But the digital compositing got a lot of people really worried.
There was a kind of big startup torque to getting the new computer-oriented digital composite people to really understand the tools that they had.
What T2 was is it gave a lot of people an opportunity to see how hard it was to do photoreal work.
Just because people had this tool set and this software didn't mean they understood anything about composite.
And they may not have the observation skills to be able to recognize when something doesn't look right when you cut it into the movie.
I found a whole bunch of really, really smart, stupid people who understood, you know, code and understood higher math and understood software at a level that I couldn't begin to comprehend. But when it came to simple things like perspective, they didn't get it. And they couldn't understand why the shots weren't working. They should have worked. The math said the shot would work, but the shot didn't look real. Why not? Well, how about perspective? How about aerial perspective? How about this? How about that? How about shadows? How about it now? All these subtle things that anybody who had a background in optical printing would understand.
We gave everybody from the original optical department a chance to be the first group in doing it. A lot of those guys have gone on to become some of our best people because they had a lot of experience in being able to judge colors and pick this and this and, you know, get things to work really good. Years of experience in that, and that has been a real advantage to some of the newcomers that came in.
On the other hand, the people that did opticals didn't want to learn or were slow in learning, so you had this gap in technique that became really obvious really quickly.
Every time there is a new technology, there is a paranoid faction of less than brilliant artists who feel that that's the end of their career, who don't understand that art never dies, that technology will go on and serve art, but art never dies.
Stan, to his credit, is one of the sharpest people that I know. And when the digital stuff came along, instead of getting afraid and clenching up and feeling invaded by it, he just leaped right over that fence and started embracing it right away.
Myself, I define myself as someone who wants to create characters. And I want to use whatever tool it is to create the most memorable character there is.
And the first thing he did was start putting in a bunch of workstations at his facility. Now, here's a guy who does rubber and hydraulics and all that, but he wanted to have this other capability as well.
The brilliant people in the field, the people like the Jim Camerons and the Steven Spielbergs and now the Peter Jacksons who understand the art of storytelling, use all the tools because it's foolish not to.
When Terminator 2 came out, and I saw that in the movies for the first time, I realized that as a filmmaker, I had to get involved in this new technology because otherwise I was going to be left behind. I mean, this was an incredible tool, you know.
I think it really opened it up to an almost infinite horizon.
It gave us ideas, took us in new directions. I mean, things we would have never...
The more processes that you can do in the digital realm, the better off you're going to be, because there's no degradation. There's no generational loss. There's no scratching and dirt in the elements. Before, we used to edit image to image. Now we edit within images. And that's the ability to blow up and move and add camera movement and take out scratches and take out objects that you don't like in frame and take elements from one shot and put them into another shot and merge two takes together, all of these sorts of things that can be done. There's no such thing as pure sound. We don't hold a microphone out and record what's happening on the set and call that some sacred document that then must be preserved all the way through to the end. The second we get that production sound, we start trying to figure out ways to make it better, putting in sound effects, putting in music, cleaning it up, doing ADR, a lot of the dialogue is post-loop. Why would we think of the image as any different than that? Why would we think of the image as something that's fixed in amber at the moment that it's photographed, and when it could be manipulated after the fact, as an artist would continue to overpaint a painting? It's an iterative process. It's constantly getting better and better and better, up to the limit of your ability to see what's wrong and manipulate it and make it better. You know, before the digital technology existed, you could imagine all those things, and then the compromises would begin at that point. Okay, I can imagine, you know, a thousand soldiers storming the castle. Well, we're only going to have 30 extras, and it's a model castle, and we're somehow going to have to use, you know, matte paintings or forced perspective, and we're going to have to, you know, you can't have 1,000, there's no way. And it used to be a situation where if you couldn't get somebody to do it, and you couldn't figure out a way to rig it so that it really happened in the real world, it wasn't going to be in your film. But now you can do it with essentially CG stuntmen, and the interaction with fire effects and water effects and everything has gotten sophisticated enough. If you can imagine it, you can accomplish it, and you can accomplish it safely. I think there's a way to do a shot in the real world. You try to do that. You look into it. If there's no way to do a shot in the real world, you do it as a digital shot. If you're going for a vision, you go after that vision first and foremost, and don't let the real world dictate to you.
Baby, this is going to blow them all away.
It's very hard to wow audiences now, because I think there's an assumption that, they just did that on a computer.
Anything you can imagine can now be put on the screen. And I think what that does, in a funny kind of a way, is it actually takes the emphasis off the special effect.
It's all right for audiences to take absolutely beautiful work for granted, because it forces us as filmmakers to constantly go back to the human connection.
This year I've seen the most brilliant performance by an actor that I can remember for many, many years. It's a completely digital character. That's the Gollum.
If a film is connecting on a human level, the audience doesn't really care how big or how spectacular things are.
It still boils down to the artist that's creating the character and creating the performance. Even that movie, though, there was digital characters, there were live action makeup characters, there was a mix, there was a blend, there was a world that was a constant blend of digital technology, miniatures, live action. It was magic, because a brilliant director didn't rely on any one technology to tell his story.
Because the best films are films that have hundreds of different factors of storytelling and character and acting and camera style all flowing together.
The computer technology becomes just another tool in the arsenal of the filmmaker, you know, a very, very potent one.
There's no fee but what we make for ourselves.
With these advances in the speed of computers and sophistication of software, you don't have to have a lot of money to start doing this stuff.
You can buy, you know, $40 worth of books at a bookstore and a couple of $1,000s in programs, and it can be one person, you know, working at his home doing it.
It enables anybody who's got an idea to be able to get that idea out.
And a lot of guys can, you know, can start on a Mac or a PC or Linux and come to us and get employed, or they can even do it, you know, in their own living room.
So, yeah, it's been, I think, great for the effects industry that so many people have had a chance to dabble with this stuff and be able to demonstrate their talent.
Because anybody can use this technology and anybody can put these images up on screen. It's not new and original anymore. It's there for everybody to use. And so, therefore, the emphasis goes back on how you use it.
The tool isn't as important as the result. And as a filmmaker, I'd love to have the tools be cheaper and more democratized.
And I think that just actually swings the arc back to storytelling again. That that special effects used to be the event, but now because they're so common, they're so easy to do with the digital technology, they're no longer the event. The event now becomes the story that you're telling.
And ultimately, I think that as long as people always make story and character the most important thing, and all of these other new arrows in the quiver secondary to that, then they're going to make good films.
Who's responsible?
I think Jim deserves a tremendous amount of credit. First of all, he had the vision, the imagination, and the creative ideas to write stories that used the expanded palette of digital filmmaking.
Jim Cameron is the ultimate pioneer in this arena. Not taking it away from anyone else, but Jim Cameron made the breakthroughs.
What he did here is essentially has opened up a whole new can of worms for the entire industry, you know, with Terminator 2.
I think that the issue is don't stop questioning and don't stop trying to figure out ways to push the ball further downfield.
Every show that you do, you're presented with some sort of new problem that needs to be solved. And, you know, once that problem is solved, it's available to all the other shows that follow.
A lot of them have come from just a few people with really sharp ideas, then leading all the other folks or showing the other folks sort of a way to do it. And everybody, and it changes. This person comes up with a great idea, and this one is here, and this one is here.
And I'm just glad that, you know, films like Terminator 2 kind of inspired me to get it going when I did, because it's really ultimately led to a growth of knowledge and experience that enabled us to do Lord of the Rings. I mean, we could never have even made that film if we hadn't been where we were at that time in regards to our CG experience.
People caught on to it and started doing some really pretty remarkable work, and we've never looked back. I mean, let's face it, as an industry, when you see something better, you glom onto it. You don't have to go out and sell it. People will find it.
Back.
Yeah.
The Ritter
can
you.
We almost go immediately after the plane.
That's your first shot, kid.
Woo!
First of many.
Yeah,
action. Go anyway, all the way across. That's it. Good.
Take the guy to check shirt.
Boy, you're caught me spitting.
No?
I'm thinking about my mouth. Right to the head.
And wind effect.
Okay, keep it going. Keep it alive. Keep it alive. Keep playing with the dog.
Let's have Jim look at it.
And it gives you a reason to come back over and go to the
back. How much distance between that car that you just added?
I knew that was going to happen.
Ready?
I told you that was going to happen.
And action!
Relax. It's okay. It's just a tire. Now look at the turbine. And cut.
Mark!
Action, Nick.
Perfect.
And then you fall. Oh, it's burning. And action, he jumps off and covers up. Oh, stop. What'd you do? What, see Commando 10 times?
Happy camper.
Now, if Arnold starts dancing again, they're, you know, really stupid. We can blackmail him with, get the camera on him right away.
All right. Let's bump it up and shoot it, huh?
Do you want me to say you'll be back?
Are you going to be back or what?
You don't have to be dead yet. Do you mind kind of falling like you're dead? This. Like that.
How's that looking, Michael?
That's the age.
No.
I popped
his face.
Oh, that's the age? Oh. I'll stay farther back.
And don't forget to make your turn. Close up.
I don't branch. You know, it's like...
And action! I got it. Thank you.
This machine is merciless.
Pretty lame kickers, man.
there.
You're not going to give this to Jim Cameron, are you? You want a rebate.
No, I don't need that.
Okay, guys, listen up. I'm out of here.
Trying to fuck her up as you get close to that lip there?
Were we supposed to roll?
That was a rehearsal.
I'm waiting for your cue, Jim.
I hate being the center of attention.
That's why I like to be behind the camera. This doesn't mean I have to be nice to you guys.
As long as it's not a flying piranha.
Rifleman, Chuck Connor would be proud.
That's the problem. We have all these American myths that we're trying to live up to.
Right. Arnold's gonna love this.
Really hit the flex, yeah, like this, yeah. It's the bathroom, and then you go down for the shoelace tie. Exactly, that's right, exactly. No camera can take all this good looks, so what they do in every movie, basically, is they put appliances on and terrible makeup on to kind of tone my looks down a little bit.
Well, 2.5-3 hours, and he's done. It'll take about a half hour to take it off at the end of the day. Thank you, Peter. How's the hair look? You schmuck. The next stage for the makeup is stage 5, 6, 7. He'll have his eye plugged up, so he won't be able to see out of it. And it'll take probably an hour, hour and a half longer to put on. He's going to love it.
I don't know how much longer I can take this. All right.
The tape is even more deceptive now.
Go ahead!
I've seen worse effects.
Clever. Fortunately, Stats is like a bandage already, so.
Right.
It's like a wound over a wound.
Turn around.
Arnold the Disco Maniac.
It's a joke. Burn this joke.
He likes me, doesn't he?
Yeah, yeah.
Michael.
It's a family thing.
Action!
Stand by to do this. On our marks, everyone.
I order you not to come.
Every day from this day on is a gift. Use it well.
And cut. Cut it.
Very nice.
That's a wrap.